follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, offer of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light out.
Let the whole world see.
Hello, and a very warm welcome to our online Sunday service here at St. Catherine's. I'm Phil, I'm the curate here, and I'll be leading you through our service this morning, and I'm joined by our wonderful service team. So we've got Hazel, who'll be bringing us our Old Testament reading.
Hello.
We've got Sonia, who'll bring us our Gospel reading and be leading us in our intercessions.
Hello, everybody.
And we've got Jill, who will be preaching for us.
Hello, everyone. Happy Palm Sunday.
Yes, it is Palm Sunday. So it's a special day on two fronts. Firstly, it's our first Sunday back in our physical service. So in a weird timey-wimey thing, I'm just going to wave to myself as I stand in the church. So hello. Hello to everybody over in church now. So it's our first Sunday back. And also, as Jill said, it's Palm Sunday. So let's begin our Palm Sunday service with our indispensable song on Palm Sunday, Ride On, Ride On.
Ride on, ride on in majesty, as all the crowds hosanna cry. The waving branches slowly ride, O Saviour to be crucified. Ride on in majesty, in lowly pomp, ride on to die. O Christ, your triumph now begin, with captured death and conquered sin. Ride on in majesty, the angel arm is of the sky. Look down with sad and wandering eyes to see the approaching sacrifice. Ride on in majesty, the last and fierce is foe defied. The Father on his sapphire throne awaits his own anointed Son. Ride on in majesty, in lowly pomp, ride on to die. Bow your meek head to mortal pain, then take, O God, your power and reign.
Oh,
So we're coming to the part of our service where we still ourselves before God to say sorry for the things that we've done wrong. And we say that safe in the knowledge that the Jesus who rode a donkey into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday forgives us our sins when we say sorry. So we come on to our confession. If you join in with the words, Christ have mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess we have failed you as did your first disciples. We ask for your mercy and your help when we take our ease rather than watch with you. Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we bestow a kiss of peace, yet nurse enmity in our hearts, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we strike at those who hurt us, rather than stretch out our hands to bless, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we deny that we know you for fear of the world and its scorn, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. So when we pray and we say sorry, we know that God forgives us. So let me pray this prayer of absolution over you to remind you that you are forgiven. So may the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So now, as God's forgiven people, we take some time to listen to him and to listen to his words. So Hazel and Sonia are going to bring us our readings, and then Jill is going to unpack them for us in our sermon.
First reading is from Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4-9. God's servants depend on God. The Lord God gave me the ability to teach, so now I teach these sad people. Every morning he wakes me and teaches me like a student. The Lord God helps me learn, and I have not turned against him. I will not stop following him. I will let those people beat me and pull the hair from my beard. I will not hide my face when they say bad things and spit at me. The Lord God will help me, so the bad things they say will not hurt me. I will be strong. I know I will not be disappointed. The Lord is with me. He shows that I am innocent, so no one will be able to show that I am guilty. If someone wants to try to prove that I am wrong, that person should come to me and we will have a trial. But look, the Lord God helps me, so no one can prove me guilty. As for them, they will be like all worthless old clothes eaten by moths.
The second reading is written in Mark chapter 11, verses 1-11. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied in a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in highest heaven.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
So, Palm Sunday, the day we recall Jesus riding victoriously into Jerusalem on a donkey, as the crowds hailed him enthusiastically, full of anticipation, joy, expectation. Their king has come, the long-awaited for Messiah. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And yet, within a week, he is crucified. The victor has become the victim. Dreams unrealised and worse than that, shattered. Until the unexpected and tremulous day of the resurrection. But more of that next week.
Yay.
Today we are focusing on Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. But not just that. As part of our Lenten series seeking to weave the theme of how we might respond to climate change, I want to focus on two things. So the first is why Jesus' entry into Jerusalem was so important. And the second is how we might be challenged to live our lives differently, to live simply, because of Jesus and all that happened on that day. So firstly, why is Jesus' entry into Jerusalem so important? And why does the church commit a whole day to its celebration? We take it all a bit for granted these days, don't we? Well, Jesus has clearly decided that the time has come to face the future that God has called him to. And he is going to Jerusalem with his disciples to, yes, celebrate the Passover. And yet he knows what is going to happen when he gets there. So a few verses before our passage this morning, we read in Mark chapter 10, verses 32 to 34 this. They were on their way up to Jerusalem, with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. We are going up to Jerusalem, he said, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise. Despite knowing this and sharing this with his disciples, Jesus still goes, leading the way, because he has a task to do. In the words of Isaiah 55-6, he has set his face like flint, ready to suffer, because he knows he has this task to do, and he also knows that the Lord is going to vindicate him. And so Jesus rides straight into the danger zone to fulfill his destiny and to face his death. As he and the disciples draw close and arrive at Bethphage and Bethany, which is just about 2 kilometres away from the big city, and they get to the Mount of Olives, the place where later that week Jesus will take his disciples to pray and where the soldiers led by Judas will arrest him. Mark tells us that he sends 2 of his disciples to go ahead to the next village where they'll find a colt tied, which no one has ridden. Why does the gospel author Mark make such a meal of this? I mean, in addition to collecting the donkey, they might have had a bit of shopping to do on the way, or washing of clothes, or visiting friends, eating meals. But there's so many verses here given over to collecting that donkey, which could easily have been left out of the gospel. Well, it seems to me like Jesus has been cooking in the kitchen without anyone noticing. He's made arrangements beforehand. And actually, this is crucial to the whole event, this riding on a donkey into Jerusalem. Had Jesus simply walked into Jerusalem, like everyone else did, there would have been little impact. But the riding into Jerusalem on a donkey was making a scandalous and provocative statement for all the world to see, because in so doing, Jesus was publicly claiming to be the Messiah, something that he had told people to keep quiet about in the previous 3 years of his miraculous ministry. Matthew's Gospel includes the same event, but explicitly tells us that Jesus does this to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Zechariah about 500 years before. Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So without using words, Jesus was saying, look, people of Jerusalem, here is your king, gentle and riding on a donkey. I am he, the one that Zechariah prophesied about. I am your king, the long-awaited for Messiah. And that's why the people were so excited and happy, so thrilled and delighted and scurrying this way and that. They understood the claim and they were overflowing with joy. This was the day that the Lord had made. Here he comes. Yes, we know who you are. You're our Messiah, King of the Jews. Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David, King David. Here he is, the one we've all been waiting for. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. And they threw their cloaks on the ground in his honour, and they took palm leaves off the trees so that they could see that they were waving at him despite all the crowds. Jesus was coming to deliver them, which of course he was, but not in the way that they had expected. Just as Simeon and Anna had predicted when Mary and Joseph had presented the baby Jesus in the temple, just as before that the shepherds had heard from the angels out on the Bethlehem hills, here was the saviour of the world, the one through whom God would accomplish his purposes and bring all peoples to himself, without guilt or shame, knowing that God cares for us in whatever we face, whatever we faced in the past, and whatever we will face in the future. As Jesus rode into Jerusalem, God's purposes were finally out of the bag and there for everyone to see. Jesus, the Messiah, God's anointed one, has arrived. Wow. But of course, the story doesn't stop there. The victor is going to become a victim before being vindicated by God. There's a glimmer of that in verse 11, which is strangely ominous and threatening in tone. Jesus entered into Jerusalem and went to the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So you know what happens next, don't you? The very next day, Jesus returns to the temple and he drives out all those who are buying and selling there, the traders and the money changers. He overturns the tables, the benches of crates of doves. He is really pretty angry. And this act of fury is actually the catalyst, the final catalyst, which leads to his death. Although I would say him riding into Jerusalem on the donkey was a precursor to that as well. And whilst we don't have time to properly do justice to what is going on here, I think it is fair to say that Jesus cares very greatly about the way we worship God, and within that, the way we live our lives, that we live differently because of what he has done for us. So Palm Sunday is a story full of hope and anticipation as Jesus, the way, the truth and the life, is finally recognised for who he is. But knowing and recognising who Jesus is means that we will want to live lives that will please him. And in terms of climate change, in the simplest of terms, that just means we should consume less. And when we do consume, we should use our buying power for good. Jesus was angry with the traders because despite doing what they did in the temple courts, they weren't honouring God in their lives. They were putting dosh above worship. And we must be sure that our own lives don't fall into the same consumerist trap, where we go along with what is normal and opt for what is easy and convenient. Ruth Valerio says a lot about this in her book Just Living, our book for Lent, and I'm going to share just a few things. We need, first of all, to acknowledge that balancing our budget with our ethics can often be a bit tricky and complicated. Nonetheless, it is good practice that when we buy, we simply need to stop and think. Ask ourselves what we know about the product, where it's come from, whether it was made with good working conditions or environmentally harmful materials. Has it been tested on animals? Has an inordinate amount of energy been needed to make it? Will the producer's life be better if I buy it? So she suggests we don't impulse buy, but before we purchase, we stop and we think. The other thing that really struck me from reading her book was that 1 in 8 people in the world are malnourished and 1 in 3 people in the world are overweight. Around 4 companies in the world controlled around 80% of the global grain trade. And only half of the world's grain harvest is eaten directly by people. A third is fed to animals and a further sixth goes to biofuels. Globally, meat eating is set to double by 2050, by which point the world's entire grain harvest will be needed to feed animals. I never understood it, but when my brother was at agricultural college, that's when he became vegetarian, precisely because of these facts. A third of the food grown in the world is wasted, and if current trends continue, all the world's fish stocks will be exhausted by 2048. And yet there are enough calories in food, 2,700 calories for every man, woman and child. To exist if only we could use our food resources well. But anyway, that's why it's important to eat less meat. Cattle produce an awful lot of greenhouse gases and huge amounts of slurry, too much to be dealt with sustainably, thus leading to the poisoning of the land and water around intensive farms as the slurry leaches out. And we don't all have to go vegetarian, although that's probably a better diet than a lot of people have. But we do have to reduce our intake of meat significantly. Just a small portion of meat 2 or 3 times a week. And remember that beef consumes a lot more resources than chicken, and pork and lamb come somewhere in between. So she suggests all that because our food consumption is where the largest proportion of our money will generally go. And Valerio suggests we eat seasonal food when we can, that we buy fish and seafood carefully, remembering that MSC blue label, and when and if possible, that we grow and rear our own, maybe joining with others to do so, having a shared allotment or shared chickens or pigs. So we're called not to just go along with society's assumptions, but to think about what we're eating, what we're purchasing, what we're consuming. So let's all be radicals. It's important to remember that if the task of changing our lives just seems too big, then we do it in little portions. Remember that sort of business model of how to eat an elephant, well, you eat elephant steaks. Not that I'm advocating eating elephants, but you do it in little points. So little lifestyle changes gradually is the way to go forward. So what has Jesus riding into Jerusalem have to do with my ethical consumption? Well, God, as I learnt at our Jonah Bible study on Wednesday, is absolutely passionate about us. He loves us, and in Jesus he has shown that once and for all. And he also loves and cares for all creation. Jesus is the one through whom and for whom all creation was made. And I don't claim to understand that fully, but Jesus preached about our attitude to money and things more than he preached about anything else, and he urged people to share, to give, to honour God above material things. And when Jesus rode into Jerusalem, he set his face like flint, as Isaiah says. He set his face like flint as he committed to do the task he had to complete, knowing that God would vindicate him, that God would help him in all that was to come. And as he rides, he declares, "Here I am, God's holy anointed one, come to save you from yourselves." As we work out our salvation, it is so important that our lifestyles complement our theology and reflects God's love and his concern and care for the world. So how we live really matters. So let me finish with one question. It's not rhetorical. What are you going to do? What long-term real change are you going to make to the way you live your life? Not because you have to, but because you want to, as your response to God, who loves us and all creation, and showed that to us when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a colt, the foal of a donkey, around 2,000 years ago, revealing who he was and what he had come to do. So if you have, along with me, cried, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," we simply have to live more simply. Consume less and contemplate more. Amen.
Thank you, Jill. So now we are going to sing, Meekness and Majesty, and then Sonia is going to lead us in our intercessions.
Eternity, health in humanity.
Let us pray together. The words and response this morning is, "You are our God, we welcome you. Hosanna in the highest." Lord Jesus, you rode into Jerusalem today on a humble donkey, with people waving palm branches and shouting loud hosannas to welcome you. So we too invite you into our lives this morning, our servant King, our King of Peace. We praise you. We love you. Help us to follow you with faith and joy. You are our God. We welcome you. Hosanna in the highest. Loving and almighty God, we pray for your church here at St. Catherine's and throughout the world. During this holy week, may we and all Christians everywhere draw ever closer to you, to be encouraged, strengthened, and to know your love for us. We give thanks for Jill and Phil and for all their enthusiasm and creativity with online worship during the last year when things have been so difficult, and for everyone here who has kept in touch with friends and neighbours, giving comfort, help and hope. Loving God, we know we can meet with you anywhere, but we thank you that we can now look forward to meeting in person, to worship you together after nearly a whole year apart. You are our God, we welcome you. Hosanna in the highest. We pray for your world and its needs. We pray for all governments and especially all in positions of leadership. Give them wise and caring hearts. As the world continues its struggle with the pandemic, we pray that your guiding hand is seen in the decisions that are taken. Let there be generosity and unity with vaccine distribution, both with our European neighbours and in countries where there is poverty and poor infrastructure. You are our God. We welcome you. Hosanna in the highest. We hold before you everyone who has been named in our notices this week, our church members, Birchcote School and local roads. We pray for those who are suffering in mind, body or spirit from the hardships of lockdown, those who have been shielding and all who have been separated from their families, for those who are sick and for those who grieve. May they all be sustained and comforted by your love for them. You are our God, we welcome you. Hosanna in the highest. Creator God, forgive us our neglect of your world, the choking waste of pollution and the damage done by our thoughtless use of resources. Help us to amend our lives and use our voices to bring about lasting change. We pray for the United Nations COP26 and for Alok Sharma, that he will be given the strength and vision that he needs as he works together to bring the world together on climate change. In all his discussions with experts, business groups and governments, we pray that everyone will be able to listen, learn and agree on courses of action. And this week we pray especially for the virtual climate development ministerial, which Alok and the Foreign Secretary will host on the 31st of March. Guide them and their partners as they identify practical steps on priority issues for countries most vulnerable to climate change. You are our God. We welcome you. Hosanna in the highest. Loving Father, as we journey with your Son in this week of remembrance and hope, help us to understand you and your love for the world more clearly. May we follow with faithfulness and joy, shouting Hosanna in the highest heaven, knowing that he welcomes all who follow him. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. And so we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, The power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So now we're coming to the notices part of our service, and I'm the curate here, so I'm learning how to be clergy, and part of that is having a regular one-to-one with Jill. And also what I'm trying to learn is how to be as efficient as possible. So I'm trying to double up my one-to-one and the notices part of the session. So Jill and I are going to do the diary part of our one-to-one meetings in front of you so that you know what's coming up this week.
So, Phil, what's coming up first of all?
The first job on my to-do list is uploading our dramatised Bible readings. So I've rendered them. I just need to upload them onto Facebook to go live at 10 o'clock each day, and you'll get a part of the lectionary reading performed by many people from St Catherine's.
I'm really looking forward to that. And I'm really looking forward to the part that Pontius Pilate plays.
Yeah, I heard a rumour there was an Oscar in the offing.
And that's replacing our morning prayer, isn't it?
Yep. So we don't have to get dressed before 10 o'clock anymore.
Okay. Well, after that, I am meeting Mr. Massey from Birch Copse at 10:45 at our Easter garden, which everyone can come and view. And at 1:30, I'm seeing Becky from preschool with children. And we're going to be planting these flowers that they've made in our Easter garden. So I'm looking forward to that. And I think, I don't know when I'm going to do it yet, but at some point during Holy Week, I will do the Easter trail from St. Michael's to St. Catherine's and get the story, the Easter story, by scanning the QR codes on my mobile. So I think that's a good thing for a vicar to do, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's a good reminder for me, actually, because we've got our Good Friday sort of family service on Good Friday, and we're going to be linking that in with the trail. Do the trail either before or after it. But if you're interested in the trail, check us out at 10 o'clock on Good Friday to see it all woven together.
Brilliant. And on Good Friday as well, in my diary, I'm leading the reflections on the cross in St. Catherine's Church at 3 o'clock. And all week, there's an opportunity for anybody to cast their burdens onto the Lord by taking a stone and putting it at the foot of the cross, which is in the corner garden in the church grounds. Which looks absolutely magnificent just now. But anyway, to have a time of prayer, and there's a little bench you can sit on and just cast your burdens or your anxieties or worries onto the Lord. So that's a very Holy Week thing to do.
Yeah, and we're still carrying on with some normal stuff as well. So our Jonah course is into week two on Wednesday. So I'll be prepping for that and then hosting at 7:45. On Wednesday via Zoom.
And Phil, we still got our one-to-one at 2 o'clock.
Yes, we have. And I've got some homework to do for that, haven't I? Because we need to crack on with that.
We have. And in my diary, I've got a deanery chapter meeting at 3, but not everybody needs to know about that. And I'm also judging preschool. They've got an Easter bonnet parade at 11 o'clock. They'll be out in the church grounds. It's a great responsibility having to judge their bonnets. So that will call for a lot of wisdom. Please pray for me.
With great power comes great responsibility. I think Spider-Man said that.
And on 7 o'clock on Monday night, I've got a church wardens meeting. So... again, that doesn't affect anyone unless you want to bring anything to our attention. Okay.
So it's quite a busy week. We've not even got on to Easter Sunday yet, have we?
No. What's happening Easter Sunday?
I think Jesus is coming back to life.
And we're celebrating. I've got a sunrise service, so I'll be doing that from my garden or maybe from the church Easter garden or by the cross. I don't know yet. It depends
if my phone will pick up a signal that far away. Anyway, 6 o'clock sunrise service. I know lots of you will be watching me still in bed, won't you? But I hope that lots of you can join me and wake up early on this very special, the most important day of celebration in the year, I would say. I think it even, what's the word? It's not climaxes, it even over eclipses. It eclipses Christmas Day, doesn't it? Easter Day. Do you think so? I don't
know. I think so.
Okay. One last thing, Phil.
Then at 10 o'clock on Easter Sunday, we got a physical service and a online service. And hopefully people will email you to let you know that they're coming to the Easter Sunday service.
Okay, that's brilliant. Well done, everyone.
There we go. So you've saved us 5 minutes off our next one-to-one, and hopefully we've informed informed our congregation about the things that go on during the week at St. Catherine's. So thank you, Jill, for sharing your diary with me. Thank you, everyone else, for allowing me to. And now we're going to sing our final song, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Oh, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God. Glory to the King of Kings. Hosanna again. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest.
So the last part, the last formal part of our service is the blessing. So let me pray this prayer of blessing over you. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and among you, now and always. So as we come to the end of the formal part of our service, we're going to have a coffee and a chat to whet your appetite for our Zoom coffee. So I'm going to ask the service team to either share with me a story of waving that went horribly wrong, as it's Palm Sunday, where they waved their palm branches. If anyone has waved to the wrong person, thinking they were someone else, they're welcome to share that with us. We've got our Aware Lent calendar, thinking about eco issues, and we've got our last couple of days this week. So I'm going to ask our team to share with me anything that they're looking forward to about this week's Lent Aware calendar. So I'm going to go to Sonia first.
Well, I think I'm focusing on the Lent calendar. I'm quite looking forward to checking out the YouTube David Attenborough's New Year message from A Perfect Planet. But also Meat Free Mondays. We've been trying really hard on Meat Free Mondays, and I think it would be quite easy to carry on, or, you know, do more than one meat free. So that's what I'm really going to try and do in the future.
Brilliant. How about you, Hazel?
Well, in my house, we generally have Meat Free Monday on a Tuesday. Whatever we've had, you know, as a roast dinner, there's, you know, there's quite often something left that I can make a curry from or something. So we have meat free Tuesdays and other days as well. But I do have a silly story about waving. I was at grammar school in 1968-69 in my first year, and a member of the royal family, it wasn't the Queen, but it was a step or two down from the Queen, came along the bypass, which came from Manchester going towards Chester, and my school was backing onto that that road. So we all got crocodiled, you know, the long way round to the dual carriageway, and we were told to wave when we saw some rather fancy cars. So there we were, very distinctive in our navy blue and red uniforms, all with red berries on our heads, and we were told to wave. So we waved, but I didn't even see anybody in the car. And even the teachers were very confused. So, I mean, there we were all waving enthusiastically, thinking I'll be able to go home and say, I've seen so-and-so today. I didn't see anybody. It was such a shame.
Oh, it's frustrating to be back at the crowd and not being able to see properly. And yeah. I like the fact you do timey-wimey stuff as well. We're timey-wimey with being here and in church, and you're timey-wimey with meat-free Mondays on a Tuesday. Jill, how about you?
I'm looking forward to doing the happy little dance on Maundy Thursday in celebration of Lent and all the be aware sort of coming to an end, although we know it's going to continue, don't we? Mm-hmm. And I hope that everyone has sort of formed little habits that will make a difference, and that we're all just a little bit more aware of the things that we can do to make a difference. But yes, doing a little happy dance the day before Good Friday, is that good theologically? I don't know, but I'm very happy to do a little dance on Thursday.
Well, I'm really glad someone mentioned the happy little dance on Thursday, because I think we should try and get them trending. If we all take videos of our happy little dances and see if we can get them flooding social media.
We could do that.
Yeah. So my story is about waving to my dad without knowing it was my dad. I used to support a rugby team called Newport. They have a very distinctive shirt. It kind of looks like a B, kind of yellow and black stripes. And I went on holiday with my friends when I was in sixth form to Han Stanton. And we were standing on the beach, and it's such a distinctive shirt. We looked along the beach, and about 400 or 500 metres away, we could see someone who was clearly wearing a Newport shirt. And we thought, I'm going to wave to that person because they're wearing a Newport shirt. So we waved. And then being teenagers, we thought, actually, let's go and have a chat with them because they're wearing a Newport shirt. So we kind of ran across the beach, tracking this person down in the Newport shirt. It turns out my dad had decided to take my mum down Stanton for the day. So it was my dad that I was waving at. So that's my, that's my waving story. We hope we have entertained, informed, and enriched your lives in this chat. Do join us on Zoom to take the chat even further. But for now, it's goodbye from us. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.